Welcome as we gather together on this beautiful Sunday morning with this beautiful greeting of music here at Davis Park. And we welcome all of those of you who are worshiping with us online as well. Those who will be assisting me in leading worship today will be Allie Hall, Mary Falkenberry, and our beautiful music by Director's Jazz Orchestra under the direction of Chris Taylor. Next Sunday is a very unique and very special Sunday for us. We will not be here at Davis Park. We will not be in the parlor at 10:45. We will be in the sanctuary for one service at 10 a.m. for our children's musical. You have an opportunity to show your children just how much you love and support them by attending this worship service. So please come and encourage them. They will be presenting faith news. So please come for that special service next Sunday at 10 a.m. Also, you will note, and we will be celebrating this coming up for our return Sunday, but you'll notice that it's in place now. We have new carpet in the sanctuary and the chapel. So enjoy. It will be a wonderful blessing to us in many years to come, but we ask that you help us keep it new by keeping your food and your coffee in the narthex rather than in the sanctuary. So we'll have a celebration, a dedication. You'll get to see pictures of how they managed to replace that carpet with all of those pews and everything that is in the sanctuary and in the chapel. We have pictures that will show that when we get back together for Return Sunday in September. Friendship Sunday is August 4th. We will be acknowledging and celebrating our friends. So invite you to bring one with you so that we can truly celebrate our friends. It's National Friendship Day, and so you are invited to participate in that with a friend. Invite them to worship with you for this hour. We also want to encourage you to write a note of thank you to a friend. We will be offering those gifts of letters to friends from you on that Sunday as well. There is more summer challenge to come for those that appreciated the reading of the book of Acts, and also those that didn't have an opportunity to do so. We will be reading the book of Romans, and those 16 chapters will read the weekdays in August. So August 1st through the 22nd, we will be reading the book of Romans. If you'd like to send me an email that I may email those chapters to you for each day's reading, you are welcome to do that. I have several that I send those messages to. And just join me. It was a wonderful experience in the book of Acts, and we anticipate a great time in the book of Romans as well. Let us now stand and greet one another with the joy of knowing Jesus Christ.
No problem.
return to our seats, let us center our hearts for worship with the music from Director's Jazz Orchestra. Worship and our opening hymn. Hear what God says about those who walk in the way of discipleship. The righteous flourish like the lush palm tree and are strong like the cedar. We are like trees planted near a steady source of water with great leaves and good fruit. Our fruit is love,
joy,
peace,
patience,
kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. God, as we come together on this day of worship, may we flourish and bear good fruit.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'd like to invite all of our children and students to come down to the front, and all of our families and educators or any people who work in the school systems to go ahead and stand up for me. And bring your backpacks. Guys, we believe that education is a universal right based on the scriptural truth that we are all created in the image of God. We all equally deserve to learn and grow in knowledge, wisdom, and grace. And so today, as we prepare for a new school year, we take a moment now to recognize and bless our families, educators, and leaders. To the parents, grandparents, and all of this community who help to care for these young people, I remind you of the words from Proverbs. Train a child in the way they should go. When they grow old, they won't depart from it. Their success in the classroom can be aided and even amplified by the love and support and direction you provide to them. Many times throughout the Bible, God tasks parents and caregivers with the responsibility of participating in the education of children. With that responsibility on our hearts and minds, we extend our hands and blessings towards you and pray together. O God, our eternal heavenly parent, bless these families, fill their homes with joy and their hearts with love. Give them energy, strength, and discernment as they raise these children, and remind them that we, their community and church family, are here to support them. Amen. To the educators and staff who serve in our schools and at this church, I remind you that teaching is not only a profession, but a calling. It's not simply a skill, but is featured in Paul's listing of spiritual gifts. Education is a channel for God's grace, and excellent leaders have the ability to transform the lives of their students. We thank you for the commitment you made to our children. We recognize that you do not simply recite information, but you teach students how to learn, understand, and apply the knowledge. With that commitment on our hearts and minds, we extend our hands in blessings towards you and pray together. Holy Spirit, the source of all wisdom, bless these leaders. Fill their schools with learning and their hearts with compassion. Give them focus, patience, and creativity as they educate and support these children. And remind them that we, their community and church family, are here to support them. Amen. To the students who stand before us, I remind you of this promise that Paul testifies to in the scriptures. The one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion. This means that while you're growing and learning at home and at school, God is working alongside your parents and teachers to form you into the person God wants you to be. God is equipping you and inviting you to be a part of the great adventure of life. At the same time, know that your voice and point of view matter. The Bible tells us, adults, not to look down on you because you're young, but to recognize that you can be an example to us in speech, behavior, love, and faith. In gratitude for all that God will do and in you and through you this year, we extend our hands in blessing towards you and pray together. Lord Jesus, who welcomed the children and held up their faith as an example, bless these students. Fill their schools with community and their hearts with wonder. Develop within them wisdom, integrity, and maturity as they learn and grow this year. And remind them that we, their community and church family, are here to support them always. Amen. All right, guys, we're gonna head over to First Kids now.
You might let them know what this is.
Oh, yes. Sure. So what they were getting are these little tags that I made, and I'm sure you can hear them all the way back there. They have little jingle bells on them. And so the idea is that every time they hear this little bell jingle in their backpacks, they'll remember that they are loved and prayed for by Anderson First. I don't know your teacher, but you'll always have a little reminder. Leadership of Alley Hall, our family ministry is growing. Recently, you have been supporting these children, youth, and families with your prayers, your donations of meals and snacks, your participation in summer of service projects. Next Sunday, you have the opportunity to support this ministry with your presence by attending the kids' musical at 10 a.m. in the sanctuary. Today, you can support this powerful, transformative ministry with your gifts. Let us give generously.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old pal said, 'cause you got a friend in me. Yeah, you got a friend in me. Folks might be a little bit smarter than I am, bigger and stronger too, or maybe, but none of them will ever love you the way I do. It's me and you, boy, and as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
Let us pray. Jesus, you do love us, and we know it through your power and presence, through your continuing gifts of grace and mercy, and of course, through your word. May our gifts today and always reflect the way you give to us. In your name, amen.
When Israel was in Egypt's land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Yes, the Lord said, go down. Moses, way down in Egypt's land, tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. Let my people go. He made old Pharaoh understand. Let my people go. And the Lord said, go down.
Joys and concerns, the hopes and dreams of our lives. May we also be open to your voice in our lives, that we may see with new eyes and hear with new ears the direction you have for us to follow. Bless, we pray, this gathering of your people, that we may grow and flourish in your love and grace for the purpose to which you have called us. Patient Father, you are slow to anger and abound in love. Help us to be like you. Let your peace that doesn't make sense fill our hearts with passion. Let your kindness and gentleness shape our responses to the circumstances and people around us. Remind us that self-control is a gift, and please help us regulate our responses and impulses daily.
Hear our prayers for those whose lives that have touched our hearts, those who are in pain, those who are ill, those who grieve, those who are celebrating your blessings. May we touch their lives not only through our prayers, but through our lives and actions as well. Guide us, bless us, uplift us, and hold us, for we are your children called to our purpose in your world. Hear all our prayers, those spoken and those hidden in our hearts. We pray all this in the power of Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today is from Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. And Proverbs chapter 25, verse 28. Like a city whose walls are broken through is a person who lacks self-control. And Romans chapter 8, 1 through 6. So now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own Son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his Son as a sacrifice for our sins. He did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us, who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. This is God's word for God's people today. Thanks be to God. Have thine own way. That's an anthem of self-control, of giving ourselves, controlling ourselves enough to give ourselves to God's control. And so we have this wonderful song that we've sung, but there's a test that in our culture has become quite the test of testing self-control over gratification. And it's a test that was first offered, first run, explored, you might say,
at Stanford University 54 years ago. And the test is simply called the marshmallow test. You may be familiar with it. You may have actually tried this at different times. But the marshmallow test, when it was run, and it's been run many times in these 50 years, and the research actually has followed the children that participated in the very original test, and with some interesting conclusions. But first of all, what they did was they selected some four-year-olds, young children, and for the test, they were set in a room at a table, set down on a chair, and in front of them on a plate was one marshmallow. And they were instructed that the person that brought them into the room, they were going to give them two marshmallows when they returned. They would have two to eat if they could wait to eat until the person got back. And so the instructor reminded them over and over and over again in the instructions, and the children then were left, sometimes for as long as 20 minutes. And they were filmed to see if what they could do, if they could resist eating the marshmallow that was set right in front of them. And it showed different tactics that they used. Some would just look around. The other instruction was they had to stay in the chair. So they'd look around, they'd look under the table, they would look at other things, trying to distract themselves. Some would kind of dance in their chair or do other movements. Some played with their hands. Some nibbled on their marshmallows. So sometimes the instructor would come back and find the majority of the marshmallow intact, but it was nibbled all around. It was in different configurations. Sometimes it had been poked multiple times. And so if most of the marshmallow was there, they got their second marshmallow to eat. And the tactic for eating their two marshmallows most of the time was two in the mouth at the same time. So as their reward. But not all the children did. In fact, some of the children, before the instructor even got out of the room, was eating their marshmallow. They just could not resist. They just couldn't wait. Even if it meant that if they waited, they even got more marshmallows. And so the test was this test of self-control. And what they discovered was that throughout the lives of these children, if they never learned self-control, these were the children that ended up in courts, in hospitals, in rehab centers, and in jail. Because they could not control themselves. They failed to do so. And they failed to learn to do so. Because having self-control is something that is learned. It's something that babies don't have it. We all know that. As we raise children, it's something that has to be taught. Now, taking a child through terrible twos, you figure by the time they're four, they've heard it, right? They know how to control themselves and what to do. That famous book, I Learned Everything I Ever Needed to Know in Life by Kindergarten. So there is something to that. We teach them how to have self-control, but it's something that we do have to learn. And we learn it in many different ways. As Christians, we hear about it in our scripture. Self-control is talked about a lot throughout Scripture, and here in Galatians 5, we have it listed as one of the nine fruit of the Spirit. We have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. One professor I had in seminary said, you know, if we took these in order, if Scripture actually listed them in order, if we got all the first of those eight We'd have no problem with self-control. If we practice love, patience, joy, peace, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, we'd have self-control. But it is something that stands alone. And it is truly a gift of the Holy Spirit. When we have Jesus Christ in our lives, it is a fruit that will show up in our lives, but one that needs to be nurtured. One needs to be fed. We need to continue to stay connected to the Holy Spirit. Because as we all know, there are times in our life where we're closer to God than other times in our life. So wanes the fruit of the Spirit. Now you might be curious why this whole list is plural. We have multiple fruit here, and it's listed as a singular word. It's because collectively, these are evident from a life in Jesus Christ, a life that is controlled, a life that is turned over to Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit acting in our lives. In Romans chapter 8, we have this wonderful passage from Paul. But basically, the first part of chapter 8 is talking about the activity of the Holy Spirit in our lives, what that looks like and how important it is for our lives. In the first 27 verses of chapter 8 in Romans, the Holy Spirit's mentioned 19 times, very strongly emphasized, and it's emphasized as the Spirit of life. You see, it's in life, the life of the Holy Spirit, that we truly have life, that we truly live our lives to their very fullest. And it's through nurturing, through feeding our relationship with Christ and the Holy Spirit. There is an old Cherokee legend that talks about a father teaching his son about life. And he said, "Son, there is a battle going on inside of you. And the battle is two wolves, and there's an evil wolf. And that wolf is angry and violent and feels sorry for itself and is evil in the world. It causes havoc wherever it goes. And then there's a wolf that represents the good in life." This story kind of reminds me of, you've seen those cartoons with the devil on one shoulder and the angel on the other? Yeah, the two wolves within. And these wolves are battling. They're battling inside of you, he told his son. Well, the son was very attentive and very curious. And he said, well, Dad, which one's going to win the battle? His father said, "The one you feed." The same way for us, folks. If we don't feed our relationship with Jesus Christ, if we don't go to him in prayer, if we don't bother to read scripture, if we don't connect with other people and studies that talk about Jesus Christ so that we can stay personally, individually connected, the other wins. We lose these gifts. We will lose self-control. Proverbs 25, that single verse, gives us an alarming picture of a life without self-control. A life without self-control is like a broken down wall. A wall in those times, in biblical times, walls around cities were built for protection, for security, meaning that who was ever inside the wall was protected. When the wall was broken down, there was no protection. They were just available for attack, even destruction, completely. So it is a life without self-control, says our scripture, says our God. It's a gift that is important to us. It affects us. It affects our health. It affects our emotions. It affects our relationships. It affects everything in our life. It's not just the people that live out of control all their life. We can move in and out of being in control of our life when we don't nurture our relationship with the Holy Spirit. Because you see, we're inviting Christ to take control, to keep us as children of his children, of being like Christ. Self-control is vital to our lives. It is something that we want to focus on. And there is an organization, you're very familiar with them because I'm sure you've heard about it. If nothing else, you've seen it on our church calendar on Saturday mornings and Monday nights. We host AA. AA has something in there that could help all of us, because self-discipline or self-control is key to everything that AA teaches. It's central in keeping their commitment to change, something that we as Christians need to hear. We need to be committed to change, to allow ourselves to be transformed by Christ, by the Holy Spirit. So self-control's important for keeping that commitment to change, for setting and achieving goals. They also promote the fact that it's there to resist temptation. Sound biblical? The Holy Spirit is there to help us do that. We don't have to. In fact, we can't on our own. And then AA also promotes self-control, not only for those first three, but also to make the changes that are needed. It also says that self-control is needed in order to have and maintain a spiritual life, in order to stay in a relationship with God. It's kind of that circle. We need to open ourselves up to the Holy Spirit that we may be more open. In my own practice, when I feed the Holy Spirit and a practice self-control, it becomes easier tomorrow, the next day, to feed the Holy Spirit and maintain self-control. As we practice it, it becomes more and more of who we are in Jesus Christ as a child of God. We're going to sing our closing hymn together, and it's Take My Life and Let It Be. And in the second verse, it begins with, Take my will and make it thine. Let this song be a song in words of our commitment to the Holy Spirit at work in us. Amen. Spirit is in control of our lives when we are living our faith, nurturing families, serving our communities. Praise God. Our education system, and you did not receive one of these, if you're part of the administration anyway, these will be at the table. I will make sure I get there real quickly after the benediction, and you can get one of these. Be sure to take one with you. It is a card with that bell that will remind you. So let us now stand for our benediction. Go now in the knowledge that you were created to bear fruit, and may you bear the good fruit of the Holy Spirit within you, including self-control. Amen.